I have been here quite a number of years, so I'm trying not to give you a Father Burke rerun today. So I'm going to talk about this from a different angle. I notice the word glory in here. This illness is not to end in death, but is for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it. So we're going to talk a little bit about the two kinds of glory, the glory of the world, the glory of sin, and the glory of God, the glory of grace, the glory of goodness. So first we need to try to define glory a little bit. So glory, kind of like love, it's a little elusive in trying to define it, but I'm going to take a stab at it. So glory could be defined as honor and power and beauty. Now you can ascribe the word glory to things of the world, you know. Our Lord talked about the lilies of the field and how they have the glory. The Heavenly Father clothes them with glory, the beauty of the flowers. And talk about, a ship. I was on the Harmony of the Seas, theoretically or technically the largest class of ship, cruise ship in the world. It's even bigger than the aircraft carriers. And so you could say the beauty of that ship, the power of that ship. And so how is it demonstrated? Well, if you've ever been on a cruise ship that's small in a storm, you know, everybody's, you know, it's rocking. Everyone's trying to hold to the walls or trying to walk down the hall. The only one walking straight are the drunk guys, because they're fine. They say somehow they're able to just walk fine. But now the Harmony of the Seas, when it went through a storm, you know, you didn't even know you were in a storm. One time we were in a storm, I didn't even realize until I got below and I looked out and I saw the size of the waves. Like, wow. I mean, it's like, I don't know, 215,000 tons. It's big. It's like an island kind of going through. So you know, you can ascribe glory to secular things, to spiritual things, to worldly things. So the word sort of has a multi usage. So we're going to talk a little bit about the glory of God and how that works. So in this context, it is for the glory of God that the Son of God may be glorified through it. What does that mean? Jesus is teaching us who he is. And he's demonstrating for the crowd this man who's been dead 4 days. Okay? It's not like he just died 20 minutes ago, you know. 4 days, buried, gone. And so Jesus shows up with a huge crowd and brings him back to life with the statement, I am the resurrection and the life. What does that mean for us? It means that our resurrection on the last day when Jesus returns to the earth comes through him and through him alone. We have it there underneath the statue, the risen Christ. We have it in the resurrection window here. And so that statement about glory of God coming through raising Lazarus from the dead, so they recognize that Jesus has absolute power over life and death, that he is God become man. So where else do we see that? I have my quote up there from Luke 24, which is after Christ had risen. It is necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory. So what does that mean? Well, we're not saying the Gloria during Lent. We'll go back to it in Easter. So we say glory to God in the highest. So God is deserving of the highest form of honor and glory given to any man or woman in history, because he is our creator. So let's look at what does God do. Why does he deserve glory? Glory to God in the highest because he has created the universe. The beauty of the stars and the moon and the sunshine and the mountains and the ocean, the flowers, everything. And glory to God in the highest because he created us and gave us life. And glory to God in the highest because after we sinned, he became a man incarnate, which we celebrate at Christmas, and then dies on the cross in the glory of sacrificial love for you and me. So glory to God for his powerful sacrificial love for us, which we reflect on when we do the Stations of the Cross. We go through and look at the glory of the sacrificial love of God at each of those stations, and it touches our hearts and helps us to love him. And that's what's so wonderful about meditating on the Passion of Christ. Same thing in the Sorrowful Mysteries of the Rosary. And so that gives us a share in his glory. It inspires us to stay away from the worldly glory, to stay away from sin. So glory to God in the highest, because he will judge the world and finally put an end to all evil. And the evildoers will be punished, and the good people who were their victims will be rewarded. And so that statement I have up there, well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of your Lord. That's over the coronation window where Mary is being crowned Queen of Heaven, Queen of Angels and Saints, Heaven and Earth. And so the Father's handing her the rosary. Jesus is handing her a staff of a share in the authority. And you have the two of them, Jesus and the Father, with their hands on the crown and the Holy Spirit above. And she's receiving her crown of glory, because she engaged in the glory of the humble service of God through a life of prayer and sacrificial love, through a life of self-denial instead of self-indulgence, and carrying her cross. And so she shares in that glory of God. So as we reflect on this, you know, the two glories, the glory of the world, the glory of God, in the movies, what do we see a lot in the movies? We see a worldly glory, glory of violence and vengeance and, you know, and anger and the impurity, you know, seduction, you know. So sometimes people, you know, we think of Darth Vader, you know, walking along, and he's got this really cool music, you know, to go with him, and he's got the outfit, and he looks menacing and powerful. But he does bad things. He kills innocent people. Now, later on, fortunately, he sort of repents, as it were, you know, and straightens his act out a little too late. But so the pull of the worldly power and glory, you know, guys in high school, what is it they talk about? They talk about who's tougher, who's stronger, who wins in a fight, you know, who's able to seduce the girls, that kind of thing. And all that world, that's a worldly glory. We have to be careful. It's going to pull us in the wrong direction in eternity. So we need to be looking to the glory of God. And so I normally talk about the connection of this gospel, chapter 11 of John, with chapter 16 in the gospel of Luke. Because, you know, Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. So you got to figure, that's beyond the near-death experience. That is the death experience. And so you have to figure, people must have said, hey, Lazarus, what did you see? What was it like? I think the answer to that is the story of the rich man and Lazarus in Luke 16. So if we go here for a second, we see the rich man who was guilty of following the glory of the world. So he would eat sumptuously each day. And so eating is good, but, you know, he neglected Lazarus. He was sitting there eating, watching him literally starve to death through the window at his gate when he could have given him food. So now he's in trouble. He enjoyed the glory of the world. Now he gets the justice of eternity. So verse 24, he cried out, Father Abraham, have pity on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I'm suffering torment in these flames. Abraham replied, my child, remember you received what was good during your lifetime. Well, Lazarus likewise received what was bad. So he's speaking very general here. But now he is comforted, whereas you are tormented. So it's important for us to recognize the distinction between the two glories, and that we seek the glory of goodness, the glory of the love of God. In the movies, we see the glory of, you know, people taking lives, and they're demonstrating power. What is Jesus doing? He's restoring life. He's raising Lazarus from the dead and demonstrating the power of life, the power of love, the power of goodness and grace, the power of the glory of God. Whole different direction. And that's what we need to do. As we go through life, you know, at the end of Mass, you're going to go forth to glory. You're like, well, what does that mean, Father? Okay. The Mass is ending to go in peace, okay? You're going to go out to the glory of having been strengthened, we hope, by the presence of Christ in the Eucharist. You're going to go out to the glory of prayer, to the glory of a life of saying no to sins of violence and vengeance and impurity, to pride that holds on to a grudge and doesn't forgive, to the glory of asking forgiveness for those you may have injured, asking forgiveness from God, the glory of denying yourself daily, taking up your cross and following in Christ's footsteps. So that at the end of our lives, we hear those lines, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord." Now, we don't want to be the guys that hear the opposite, you know, where they're called evil and unfaithful servants, and they enter into the punishment for the devil and his angels. That's in Matthew 25. Again, if you ask me, probably, if not the scariest, one of the scariest lines in Scripture. So we need to recognize the two directions that we can go in life. Lazarus was a man with his sisters, you know, Martha and Mary. They love Jesus, and they're the ones we need to follow. The Pharisees are the ones we need to flee from. We need to avoid. The Pharisees wanted the worldly glory. It says in Scripture that they sought more the honor and glory of men rather than the glory of God. We need to seek the glory of God, not the honor and glory of men. And so where do we find that? Well, in secret. What does Jesus say? When you pray, close your door, go to your inner room and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. So everything that's public or secret is openly known to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, all three. And so we are called to imitate Christ. And our Father who sees all that is done will reward us, will bless us. And so we want to go with the heavenly glory. We want to go with the glory of goodness, the glory of grace, the glory of saying no to sin, the glory of saying yes to prayer, the glory of saying no to violating the Ten Commandments and yes to the works of mercy. That's the path that we wish to follow. So that on the day that we die, the Lord calls us, and on the last day, the Lord will raise us up, for he is the resurrection and the life. He is our resurrection. He is our life.